We went through many descriptions or characteristics of what it is or what it means to be like the Lord and to follow His image and to follow His steps. So I thought it was appropriate to speak more about maybe the culmination of the road, of being like Christ or of being holy as the Lord commanded us to be holy as He is holy. In a sense, the topic is too simple and too complicated at the same time, because most of us have a rough idea of what holiness is like, but we struggle to live, oftentimes, a holy life. And so we'll talk about three main parts. You know, what is it? And I think we already described it in the past, but so we'll be brief. The second thing, just some steps to holiness. And I did mention it in the past as well, more related to consecration, as we'll see. And then the last part will be, what are some obstacles that we face and weapons that we could use in times that we face these obstacles? So the first thing, the first characteristic or description or definition of holiness, anyone have a good idea? It's not a hard question. At least I think. Separated. Very good. to be separated, as St. Paul starts his epistle, Paul an apostle, separated from the gospel of God, or appointed for the gospel of God. Very good. Any other definitions? That's not the only one. Of holy, or holiness, or agios, yes. Yes, very good. Where did you get that from? Yes. So you're the linguistic expert, but geos, or that part, is reflecting the earthly or the worldly or the physical, right? So, and the a, the pronoun, right? No, prefix. Thank you. Is the part that negates. Very good. So, simply, something is that is not of the world, or separated to be not of the world. So sometimes God defines Himself in a way, or sometimes we use characteristics of God that are, like we say, this similar. So instead of describing what He is, we can also describe Him what He is not. So God is not changeable. God is not limit, doesn't not have limits. He doesn't die. And so forth, right? He is incomprehensible, unchangeable. And St. Gregory goes through a lot of these characteristics in his Divine Liturgy. It's very beautiful and theological at the same time. But to be brief, this is one reason why we use this term. For holiness. It's mentioned, this word is mentioned hundreds of times in the Bible, depending on which translation you use or which form of the word that is used. Some people calculate to be 500, some people 600 or more. But in essence, when this word is used, it's to describe God, obviously, especially in the New Testament. When we describe the Holy Spirit, the holy city of Jerusalem, heaven itself, the angels, the saints, and the Christians as well. So one thing, though, about this word, when we are called to be holy, holiness is not sinlessness. For when we talk about God, yes, that's true. But when we talk about us, it can't be true. Why? Is it possible in this body to be sinless? 100%. No. So God is not going to ask us to do something that we can't do. Okay? But it's very close. It's very close to that level. And at the same time, we can't say, okay, so I'm sinful. No problem. Okay? Are we all, we all sin, but that doesn't mean we're called to sinfulness. Okay, so there's a continuum of if you will of sin, and we're not called to be sinful, and we're trying to be sinless, but we know we can't fully reach that point until maybe we are glorified with Father in heaven. But when we get closer to that state, then we can call that phrase being holy. Does that make sense? I don't want to get too theological. But I think we all understand the gist of it. So now that we go deeper into what is holiness, the best definition of being holy is God. And that's why when the Lord asked us or called us or commanded us to be holy, he uses the description of himself. Whether it is in the Old Testament or in the New Testament, he says the same thing. Be holy for I am holy. And this is mentioned several times in the Old and New Testaments, especially in the book of Leviticus. And when in the book of Acts, when St. Peter gives his great sermon on the day of Pentecost, which we'll read next Sunday, it's very extensive. He talks about a lot of things, but when he describes the Lord Jesus Christ, he uses this important characteristic to reflect his divinity, but also to show how we have to treat God. He said, "The God of our fathers glorified his servant Jesus, and his son as well, whom you delivered up and denied in the presence of Pilate when he decided to release him, but you denied the holy and righteous one, the author of life." If you remember in the Divine Liturgy, there's two main times in the liturgy where we say holy, holy, holy. One in the Liturgy of the Word and one in the Liturgy of the Faithful. Yes, the hymn of the Cherubim before the prayer that we call Agios, because Abuna. So we say holy, 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 Lord of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. And then Abuna says Agios, 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 right? And then he translated again in English. And so that's the part of the main part, or the holy, the prayer of Agios that we say in the Liturgy of the Faithful. And then in the Liturgy of the Word, so we say three times Agios, or tri, sagion, right? That's where we get the word trisagion, which is when we say Agios, right? Holy God, holy mighty, holy immortal, okay? Why am I bringing this up? Is because this is not something we should overlook when we describe God and when we try to enter into the presence of God. And I'll get to this in a minute, but when Isaiah saw the glory of God in chapter 6 of his prophecy, he was like to the point of, he felt so unworthy to be in his presence. He said, "Woe is me, a man of unclean lips." In the book of Revelation, we see part of the heavenly worship that happens, that St. John witnesses. He sees the holy incorporeal creatures praying or praising God, saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and who is to come," or "who was and who is to come." Again, there's a difference between the holiness that we are called to, which we'll get into in a minute, and then the holiness of God. And if you notice, also in some of the hymns, sometimes we don't just say Agios for God, but we put him actually on a higher level. Anyone know the term? Well, we don't. And I think we have to maybe change the response for the hymns at the end of the liturgy. But when we say in Greek, Iso Panagios Patir, Isos Panagios, Isos Panagios, and to admit, why? We say, "You are the all holy." Okay, so there's a little difference between holiness and the all-holy, like the perfect. That's why I think we should, there's actually two responses that the congregation can say. And so there's the one that we're saying is correct, but whenever we say it in Greek, we always say the other one. One is the all-holy Father, one is the all-holy Son. It's a small, you know, change, but it means a lot, okay? So let's go more deeper. Well, what is holiness? It's not just the characteristic of God, but is our calling, and it is our commandment to be holy. As St. Peter reminds us, but he who called you is holy, and we know that God is holy, you also be holy in all your conduct, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. And this word, agios, in the Greek and in the Coptic, if you notice, the translation for the word saint is also agios. So it's confusing sometimes. So when we call someone saint, we say agios. And we say someone holy, agios. This just means, okay, once you reach the level of holiness, you can be called a saint. And when St. Paul writes his epistles to, especially the Ephesians, but to other, the Romans and other cities as well, he tells them, you are saints. He says, to the saints who are in Ephesus. That's how he starts out. And some people say, no, we can't call you saint now because you're not in heaven yet. And yes, there's the whole level of canonization, all that, the organization of the church. But sometimes we don't realize that we are not just called to be good people or not to do anything bad or to struggle against. Yes, we're supposed to be all doing all these things, but we can't just shoot for passing the class. We have to shoot for getting an A+. Okay? I don't know about you, but in college, whenever I had a friend, I never took a pass-fail class, but whenever we had friends that took these classes, what happened? Most of the time, they were struggling just to pass. Why? Because they knew all you have to do is get a whatever 60% or whatever. So that's all they were shooting for. And if it were not a pass-fail class, they probably would have done fine because they would have put a lot more effort. Why am I saying this? A lot of times when we think of heaven, we think of heaven as a pass-fail class. What do I need to do just to get into heaven? I have to be a good person. I'll just stop doing this. I'll confess. Yes, but we have to raise the bar higher. And that's why the Lord said, be holy, for I'm holy. Be perfect as your Heavenly Father is perfect. So, this kind of, I'm focusing on this because it changes the way we look at our calling and what God is asking of us. He just doesn't want to get us to get a C or a C+ or even a B+. He wants us to shoot for the stars, to be like Him. And we know, again, we can't be perfect. We can't be all holy. We can't be sinless, but the more we strive for this, let's just say God wants us to be saints. He wants our name to be written in the Synaxar one day, and our relics to be in the church. I think, that's a good goal instead of saying, we're not going to be like God, but we're called to be saints. It sounds funny. A lot of times when I say this to people, they think it's a joke, but that's our calling. And that's why St. Paul, when he first starts out to the Ephesians, says, to the saints who are in Ephesus and faithful in Christ Jesus, just as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. So this is our, it's mandated of us to be saints. So he chose us that we should be blameless or without blame before him in love, and that also we should be holy. Okay, so again, why does he use the two descriptions? Because blameless is more of a state of not doing something wrong, or not be to have any blame for or accusation of committing any crime or any sin. But holiness, like we said, is the second part of being separate and being like God. Okay, any questions so far? So, having said that, because it's a mandatory calling and commandment of us, then it's something that we have to pursue. As St. Paul says in his epistle, pursue peace with all people and holiness. It's something that we strive for on a daily basis, without which no one will see the Lord. So here St. Paul is saying, if you don't strive for holiness, you're not going to see God. You're not going to be in heaven. You're not going to be like him. So if we're not like him, then we can't be with him. And if we don't strive for holiness or to be a saint on earth, then we won't be holy or a saint in heaven. Okay. And it's okay, though, because we know that this is our calling, and then we recognize our sin, to feel bad for that. And that's what we call repentance, as we described. And that's what happened to Isaiah when he witnessed the holiness of God. I'll read a small part from Isaiah chapter 6. He says, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lifted up. The train of his robe filled the temple, and above it stood the seraphim. Each one had six wings. With two he covered his face, with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. This is where we get the description of the cherubim and the seraphim that we mention in the Divine Liturgy. it says, and one cried to another and said, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of glory. That's where we get the hymn. Okay, and the posts of the door were shaken by the voice of him who cried out, and the house was filled with smoke. That's why we say this and we bring the Sharia. Okay, notice all the connections with this and the liturgy. Okay, and then he says, so woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips. When we enter into the presence of God and the holiness of God, we realize, oh, wait, I'm still a sinner. I'm not perfect. I'm not sinless. So we feel bad, but anyone know what happened next? He said, what was me? And then he died or he left. No. Notice this. It says, for my eyes, he says, I am a man of unclean lips. I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips. So I'm not separate from these people. My eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts. Then one of the seraphim flew to me, having in his hand a live coal, which he had taken with the tongs from the altar, and he touched my mouth with it and said, behold, this has touched your lips. Your iniquity is taken away and your sin is purged. So this shows us the next point that we're going to talk about, our steps to holiness. We can't be holy without God's intervention, without the communion that we have with God through the saints, through the angels, but more importantly, through the sacraments. Because this fiery coal that came from the altar and this through the heavenly ministers is what? Symbol of the Holy Communion. okay. I think you all kind of know this. That's why. So, how do we be holy? We'll briefly talk about just four points regarding to this. The first is to be separate. The second is to be purified by the grace of God. The third is to be transformed or transfigured. And the fourth is to manifest this glory or this transformation or this purification to the world. And so the only way that the creation can become like the Creator is to be separate from the creation and to be united to Him, separate in a figurative sense. Like we say, when something is consecrated, it is separated from common use and it's used for God's use. As St. Paul mentions in his epistle, he says, for you are the temple of the living God. As God has said, I will dwell in them, I will walk among them, I will be their God, and they shall be my people. Therefore, come out from among them and be separate, says the Lord. So God is calling us to to come out from among the sin in the world and be separate. That doesn't mean we open up a new city and we all live there and we have no communication with the people in the world, but in a figurative sense we have to do this. In our daily lives, we have to say, no, that is not for me, because I am part of God and I will not take part in this sin. We're talking about sin here, of course, and everything that is associated with it. Same thing happened with in the story of Abraham. I won't go in depth, but it says, by faith Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to the place which he would receive as inheritance. So sometimes God is calling us to go out of our present situation and to be separate. Again, there's many other verses here, but we won't go into depth of that. But one other quote from Leviticus, and you shall be holy to me, for I the Lord am holy, and have separated you from the peoples that you should be mine. So part of the living the holy life is to sacrifice certain things for the sake of the holy life.